for the month of February. So this CME is titled NeoTalk. So the name itself is self-explanatory. During these difficult times, learning has moved to these platforms like Zoom, which has convenienced us more. In fact, so we are all happy that we could hear a lot of very experienced and renowned neonatologists in the comfort of our own homes. So without much ado, we would like to welcome Professor Dr. J. Kumuda on this e-lecture. Welcome, ma'am. Kumuda ma'am actually requires no introduction at all. She is well known throughout India and even globally. So for people who at least don't know her, madam is currently the expert advisor to the Tamil Nadu National Health Mission. And also madam is the head of department of neonatology at Savita Medical College. But earlier she was the former head of neonatology at the renowned Institute of Child Health at Hospital for Children. So she, we know her as a bridge between intensive neonatology and community neonatology, because even though she has done a lot of work with in neonatal intensive care, her heart is and towards more towards the need of community neonatology, and that is her passion. And she has taken forward the legacy of our late Professor Dr. JM. And we know her as a teacher, as a researcher, as a scholar, and more importantly, a very humble and dedicated neonatologist. It's a pleasure for us to have madam on board. And it is also a pleasure for us to invite the entire team of Tamil Nadu NNF and also other neonatologists, renowned neonatologists from across the across India, and some delegates who have logged in from outside India to this NeoTalk series. So without much ado, I'd like to hand over the proceedings to Professor Dr. J. Kumuda, and she will introduce our esteemed speaker. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Sridhar. Indeed, a great pleasure, thanks for the opportunity, Dr. Giridhar. And I have the pleasurable job of introducing our eminent speaker of the day, Dr. Sridhar Kalyanasundaram. His CV was sent to me and is very illustrious. And he has started his life as an undergraduate best outgoing student of Stanley in 1995. And he completed his pediatric program from JIPMA, the prestigious central institute, and neonatology from PGI Chandigarh. And also he's completed his MRC PCH UK in 2005, and also a fellowship in 2006. And has been working in Glasgow from 2005 to 2012. And then he has moved to Dubai, and he has been heading the neonatal intensive care unit there. And he has moved to many hospitals like Zuleika, Al-Azhara, where currently he is there, since 2020. And his passion, his subjects of keen interest is neurodevelopment, respiratory support, and neonatal intensive care. And so I think we are going to have the pleasure or the feast of having the apnea of prematurity, which is an important topic. And all of us, when we had started our life, apnea of prematurity used to be the very stressful if you are on duty, because we had only aminophylline then. And the next thing we used to do is sit and keep stimulating the baby. And when we get tired, we used to make the mothers keep stimulating. And in fact, we have saved. But maybe after caffeine, we had a better life. But Dr. Sridhar is going to talk to us more than that. What is the current knowledge about apnea prematurity, and how are we going to manage in the current scenario? Again, I hand over the mic to Dr. Sridhar Kalyanasundaram, sir. I'm indeed very happy that you could talk to our friends in Tamil Nadu. As Dr. Giridhar said, Zoom has given us a platform for meeting people who are very experienced and have the great knowledge, and this sharing across the globe, not only across the country. And again, I welcome senior members like Dr. PMC Nair, Jaleel, and others. For want of time, I'm not mentioning other names. Over to Dr. Sridhar Kalyanasundaram.
So much. much, Professor Kumuda. It's an honor to be introduced by you, and I've heard so much about you. And when he said you are the national advisor for the state, I'm humbled to know, because I was just discussing the same topic with you a couple of minutes ago. So hearing from the horse's mouth on the same topic. Thank you for your advice. Thank you, Dr. Giridhar and Dr. Usha, for helping organize this. And it's a pleasure to be with my own fellow state members. And NNF all over India is doing a great job. We have opened the branch in UAE, for which I'm having the honor of being the president. And it's been a great advance. The last 10 years or so, the neonatal field in India has been blooming, and all the DM neonatology candidates, the DNB fellowships, everything has helped. And as Professor Kumuda was saying, we have come a long way. It's very interesting that she mentioned that we used to stimulate the babies and mothers used to stimulate. We have done all that in Chandigarh. I know Giridhar remembers very well, and Professor Nair is here. He was our senior much before that, and he remembers everything as well in the emergency in PGA, how we used to train the mothers to give ambu bagging. And we also have ventilators where the gloves were attached and they used to tickle the baby. So that was the UK style of stimulating. So they used to connect a glove and it used to stimulate the mother. So moving on from that, I'll share my screen now. It will be a reasonably detailed presentation on apnea of prematurity, focusing on the current updates mainly, which will be focused on the caffeine and the treatment part of it. Can you all see my screen?
Yes, sir. It's well seen, sir.
Okay. You can see the slides, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So this is the outline. I mean, we will be having an overview, but as I said, the focus will be on the management part, especially the caffeine and the recent advances related to caffeine use. I think we can have the questions in the end, just so we don't interrupt the flow. All of you might be familiar with this recent document by Professor Aikenwald. This came in 2016, and they recognized apnea of prematurity as one of the areas where you need to have a clear knowledge of what you're doing, especially when it comes to discharge planning, when to stop caffeine, whether to monitor at home, is there any risk with sudden infant death, and so on. So this is a good starting point to know the clinical management of apnea of prematurity. So just to define, it is a cessation of breathing in a preterm neonate for more than 20 seconds, or it can be for a shorter duration if it's associated with bradycardia or desaturation. So this is what we are learning right from our initial days. And bradycardia in a premature infant is considered significant when the heart rate slows by at least 30 beats per minute. Most of the monitors are set at an alarm limit of 100 beats per minute, so that can be taken as a reasonable cutoff so you don't over-diagnose the problem. And the saturation level less than 85%, again, the alarm limits vary between units, and we want the saturation targets of 88 or 89 to 95% in most of the units. So the alarm limits may be a little lower than that. So this would fit with the alarm limits in most of the units. 86 to 88 is what most people keep. The target is different from the alarm limit as well. So if your alarm goes off for either of these two reasons, it's most likely related to apnea. So the lower the gestation, the higher the incidence, and the more likely it is to need treatment. We can assume that all babies who are extreme premature, less than or equal to 28 weeks, were diagnosed with apnea during their course. This is just physiology for them to be having physiologic apnea. And 85% of infants born at 30 weeks gestation, and then when it comes to 34 weeks, about 20% may still have. Obviously, the more premature they are, the longer it continues, the more mature they are, like the 34-weekers, you may not have a pronounced problem. You monitor them for 3-4 days, and if they are well, they can go home. So what are the factors contributing? So this is one area I will go a little bit in detail so everyone understands the basic respiratory physiology. So we have immaturity of the respiratory control as a predominant factor when it comes to central apnea. The respiratory reflexes play a role both in central and obstructive apnea. And the upper airway factors play a role in obstructive apnea mainly. And we have associated conditions as well. So the factors implicated in the pathogenesis can be central, which includes decreased central chemosensitivity. We'll be discussing a little bit about each of these as well as we go on. We have the hypoxic ventilatory depression, which is a kind of a paradoxical response to hypoxia. Upregulation of the inhibitory neurotransmitter. So this is one of the key mechanisms of caffeine's action. Adenosine is a inhibitory neurotransmitter, and caffeine inhibits adenosine receptors. and it's a delayed central nervous system development. That's why under 28 weeks, it's almost routine to have apnea. In terms of peripheral reflex pathways, we may have decreased or increased carotid body activity. We may have the active laryngeal chemoreflex. I mean, when we debate the role of reflex role, this comes in a lot. And we have the excessive bradycardic response, the vagal tone, which is predominant, and also the coordination of the upper airway musculature as well comes in here. So this is a simple overview of the respiratory control. So we have the respiratory centers in the medulla and the pons. We'll be looking at it in the next slide as to what the centers are. And we have the central control of the breathing. So this is a volitional control. We can hold our breath as we want. We also can control the breathing subconsciously when we speak, for example, or when we are singing. So that involves control of breathing, but that doesn't need much thought or input. So both these higher controls come from the cortex. We have pain and emotional stimuli acting through the hypothalamus. So when a baby is anxious, when there is a pain stimulus, they may hold their breath, and that is related to this area. We have the central and peripheral chemoreceptors. So the central chemoreceptors on the surface, and the CSF pH and the carbon dioxide levels are going to affect this. So we learn about this when we talk about why we shouldn't use bicarbonate to correct severe acidosis immediately, because you may have paradoxical central acidosis. That's through the effect on these chemoreceptors. And we have receptors in the muscles and joints. That is why you breathe more when you are exercising. In a baby, even feeding is an exercise. And we have the peripheral chemoreceptors. The ones in the aortic body deal more with the blood pressure regulation, but the ones in the carotid bodies deal more with the oxygen carbon dioxide related changes. So the carotid bodies are more sensitive to oxygen, while the central chemoreceptors are more related to carbon dioxide and the hydrogen ion, the pH. In addition to that, we have the stretch receptors in the lung and the irritant receptors, which feed back in a negative way. So they inhibit breathing when they are stimulated. So we have these centers. We have the pons, where we have the pneumotaxis center. So the pneumotaxis center can override the apneustic center, and that is related to increasing the respiratory rate when you need it. The apneustic center is a more primitive center, and this is responsible for the gasping breathing we take in secondary apnea babies. Just before the secondary apnea, we see the gasping breathing. In a terminally ill child, we often see the gasping breathing. That's because the other centers are failing, and the apneustic center takes over as a last resort. So the pre-Botzinger complex is in the upper medulla, just above the ventral respiratory group. And this is now the respiratory pacemaker, and all the other feedback mechanisms work through this to some extent. The dorsal and ventral respiratory group is also related to respiratory control. So it is these neurons and these centers we are talking of as immature when it comes to premature babies, but it's not just the central immaturity. It's also the different reflexes that act with it. So these are the various, in a nutshell. So we have the different centers which we described now, and the pontine and medullary receptors, as well as the cortical control. When we come to the central sensory input system, we have the mechanoreceptors. We'll be looking at the reflexes in the next couple of slides. The metaboreceptors, which are related to skeletal muscle, and the exercise-related increase in activity, and so on. Peripheral chemoreceptors, we discussed that, and the central chemoreceptors as well. And finally, the action happens through the lungs for the gas exchange. The diaphragm and the external intercostals are the primary inspiratory muscle group, and the abdominal muscles and the internal intercostals control expiration, which is mostly a passive process, but you may have to be active in certain situations. And the upper airway muscles, the coordination between the upper airway muscles and the diaphragm contraction, these are all factors which cause obstructive apnea, because upper airway muscles are more sensitive to the inhibitory actions. And so we may have obstructive apnea in the premature babies. So the fetal respiration, the baby does breathe when they are in the womb, the fetus does breathe. And this fetal breathing movements are very important for lung growth, as we know. In conditions where the fetal breathing is inhibited, the lung may not develop normally. So diaphragmatic hernia is an example where the intestinal contents in the chest don't allow the lung to have the fetal movements, breathing movements, and so they don't grow well. And the fetal respiration is non-continuous. It's mostly seen during the rapid eye movement sleep. Because the fetus is in a hypoxic environment, hypoxia inhibits the central drive in utero. And the biphasic response to hypoxia that we see in the premature neonate could be a continuation of this, just like persistent pulmonary hypertension is an extension of the in utero state. the paradoxical hypoxic response, inhibition of the breathing when the baby's hypoxic is more active in the preterms due to the in utero continuation. We also have delayed maturation of the synaptic connections in the brainstem in the babies with apnea. So when you compare premature babies with apnea with those who don't have apnea, we see a significant difference in the maturation overall. Neurotransmitters like GABA, adenosine inhibit the respiratory drive. And we have an altered response to hypo and hypercapnia in babies with apnea. So this is an illustration of why this altered difference is there and how it works. So in a normal baby, for example, the CO2, when it rises from 35 to say 40 plus, the baby starts increasing their minute ventilation as a compensatory mechanism. And when we have infants with apnea, there is a shift to right of the CO2 responsiveness. So we have an increase in the threshold. So from 35, the starting point goes to 45 plus. And at the same time, the response is also relatively less. So the slope of the curve is flatter. Both these aspects are clearly seen when you have infants with apnea. So one of the importance of this is in relation of risk of sudden infant death. We will see later that the babies with apnea of prematurity do not really show a significant difference when it comes to SIDS rate, because these maturations happen by 43 weeks, while the major risk for sudden infant death happens after 46 weeks. So this reduced CO2 responsiveness is one of the factors that leads to sudden death, but it's not necessarily due to the prematurity. So the respiratory reflexes that we discussed, the stretch receptors in the intercostal area, there is the intercostal phrenic inhibitory reflex. When the chest wall is distorted, the baby has a response by brief pause in the respiration. This is a central effect, as I showed you in the earlier slides. And this is very important because during the rapid eye movement sleep, for example, the baby is relatively hypotonic, the chest wall can be easily distorted. And by reducing the distortion of the chest wall is one of the mechanisms how CPAP acts, and it's also the mechanism by which your prone position is going to help the baby. The Herring-Brewer reflex is also active. We have the inflation-related Herring-Brewer reflex, which is the more important component. So here the stretch inhibits the baby's breathing. And irritant reflexes, there is a noxious gas stimulation which can induce apnea. When there is a sudden burst of cold air, the baby may start holding the breath. We also have the trigeminal reflex, where if you hold the mask too tight on the face, we may have vagal stimulation and the baby may become apneic as well. In terms of the upper airway chemoreflex, we also call it the laryngeal chemoreflex. The interarytenoid receptors, when they are stimulated, they cause apnea. So this happens if the area comes in contact with water droplets or milk. As you can see, the foot pipe is very short in babies and the larynx is fairly anterior as well. So anything that is refluxing or when the baby has secretions, both these can irritate that area and the baby can have. That's why secretions can cause apnea as well, or reflux can produce apnea. The chest wall, we described the importance of the chest wall in relation to the stretch receptors and the intercostal phrenic reflex. A high compliance chest wall is more distorted. So the more premature the baby, the chest wall muscles are not well developed. So you have higher distortion. The hypopharyngeal muscle tone is also reduced in preterm babies. And we discussed rapid eye movement sleep or active sleep compared to quiet sleep. So in quiet sleep, we have a regular breathing pattern and there is less chest wall distortion as the tone is maintained. However, in rapid eye movement sleep, we have a reduced tone of the muscles, chest wall distortion, and the tone of the airway muscles is reduced. So we get more apnea during the rapid eye movement sleep as well. So this is about the respiratory control and the factors related to the apnea itself. We also have other contributing factors. So some of these are controversial, as you'd all recognize. So gastroesophageal reflux has been studied in umpteen different research projects. No one has really shown a clear response. You do have physiologic and logical plausibility, and that's why some of us still treat in the extreme cases. But routine treatment is an absolute no-no, because the medicines you use to treat reflux are not good for the baby in the first case. If you are using acid suppression, that's shown to increase the risk of NEC or even sepsis. And motility agents have effects on the heart. Sisapride was an example where we started using it and we burnt our hands. And even though some other medicines are available, you don't need to routinely treat, because this is physiologic as well. So you address the reason for it. You can adjust the feeding interval. You can adjust the position of the baby, but avoid using medication. In terms of anemia, there is clear evidence that when you have a better oxygen carrying your hypoxia is reduced, so you have less reason for apnea. So if a baby is sick and has apnea with hemoglobin, which is significantly lower, you may have a slightly higher threshold than what you would use. There are many studies which are looking at the transfusion thresholds, and recently you don't want to go to extreme lower cutoffs. At the same time, you don't want to transfuse too aggressively as well. So you have to be reasonably conservative when it comes to bloodletting as well as when it comes to transfusion cutoffs. But a baby who has recurrent apnea, you may have a slightly higher threshold than a baby who doesn't have, especially if the apnea is clinically troublesome and not responding to the other measures. If there is airway abnormality like laryngeal edema or narrowing in the post-extubation period, you may induce apnea as well. And thermoregulation is an important component, because if the baby is overheated, they may have apnea. If the baby is cold, they may have apnea as well. So you want to keep them in the thermoneutral zone. You want to keep the settings as close to the normal as possible. And after the first 2-3 days, I prefer to keep the babies on the air mode rather than servo mode, because the servo mode tends to keep them in the warmer zone. So they are more likely to develop apnea in that. Secondary apnea, obviously, we will discuss when we discuss the differential diagnosis. So here the apnea is a manifestation of an underlying problem like sepsis or an electrolyte abnormality. So in terms of periodic breathing, it's a fairly normal phenomenon. So it's not apnea itself, but I just wanted to mention it here so it's clear what the periodic breathing is. It's a period of regular respiration followed by apneic periods of less than 10 seconds, which occurs at least thrice in succession. So you observe the baby, and there are periods when the baby has fast breathing and then slows down, and they have a pause, which is less than 10 seconds. There is no desaturation or bradycardia in these cases. It's usually not seen in the first 2 to 3 days of life due to the, obviously, the stress hormones and things related to the delivery. There's 2 to 6% breathing time in term babies, and up to 25% of time in preterm babies may be periodic breathing. And it usually resolves by 39 to 42 weeks. So it's a relative maturation related issue. This is prominent during active sleep as well, and CPAP eliminates it. So some of the basic principles may be similar, but it's not as extended as apnea. So it's physiologic. So this is an illustration, the somnogram showing the polysomnography, which shows us the periodic breathing. So you have, I said more than three. Here we have multiple episodes. It may not be as prominent in a routine case, but here the baby is breathing a little fast at times, then stopping, then a sudden gasp-like breathing, and then it starts increasing again. No significant desaturation or bradycardia, and the flow again has interruption at the same time. So it's both the thorax and the flow happen, so it's a central phenomenon. Coming on to the classification of apnea itself, I briefly mentioned earlier about central and obstructive apnea when I was talking about the role of different mechanisms. So we have central apnea, which counts for 30 to 40%. So there is cessation of both the airflow and the respiratory effort in central apnea. In obstructive apnea, which leads to 10 to 20% of cases, we have cessation of airflow in the presence of continued respiratory effort. So basically, the drive is there, but the gas flow doesn't happen because upper airway is closed, either due to secretions or because of the hypotonia of the pharyngeal muscles. And mixed apnea happens in the majority of cases. So whether you start with central apnea, after a brief period of hypoxia, the pharyngeal muscle tone drops and it leads to an obstructive apnea. And in obstructive case, because of the hypoxia, which happens from the lack of gas flow, the hypoxia stimulates the central depression of respiration, and then central component sets in as well. So either obstructive or central, if it is prolonged enough, it will lead to mixed apnea. So you'll have both elements of central and obstructive apnea. So this is central apnea. You can observe here that the thoracic breathing movements are not picked up and the flow is not picked up. After a certain length of time, you have the bradycardia and you have the desaturation. So the lower it goes, the longer it takes to pick up. And in terms of obstructive apnea, this baby is just recovering from an episode and then has one more episode. You can see that the thoracic movements are maintained, but you have the flow which is stopping, and then the bradycardia and the desaturation happen as well. So this is a typical example. And as I said, once it extends long enough, the baby stops breathing as well. So the nursing staff who is watching the baby may be able to differentiate what is happening here. So if the baby has a sudden bradycardic episode, which quickly comes back without desaturation, that is most probably related to the reflex laryngospasm, the associated vagal-related bradycardia. So it's not an apnea by itself, but a sudden dip in the saturation happens when they are looking at the screen. It comes back up within a few milliseconds, or like it goes up to 80 and comes up to 110 within no time. The baby who is showing breathing movements but starts desaturating and then goes apneic is having an obstructive episode. And the baby who stops breathing, as you see the monitor, the saturation starts dropping. That's more a central apnea. So little more detail about reflex itself. So there is no clear evidence which shows this, because the studies have looked at the pH electrode-related changes with the apneic episode changes, and they have not found any correlation. The same way, the treatment causing a benefit has not been shown as well. However, as I said, there is physiologic plausibility that the laryngeal chemoreflex is active in premature babies, and we do see bradycardia and apnea following feeds in some babies. And when you make changes to the feeding pattern, you do see a clinical response. There are medications which do reduce the symptoms. So it has a physiologic plausibility, but for the reasons I explained earlier, we shouldn't rush to treat these episodes, control them in as physiologic way as possible, and individualize the management. So avoid the proton pump inhibitors or any medicines like that. Ranitidine is, of course, withdrawn. And we have domperidone, for example, which can be used in very, very remote situations. Infant Gaviscon should not be used in the very tiny babies as well. So we have some benefit from those in very, very limited cases. So very individualized management, use it for the minimum possible period, only after all the other measures have failed. And believe me, we had prolonged usage in my unit in UK, and then we decided that we shouldn't use it, and we tried to hold on, and it disappeared from our practice. So it's more a habit more than a necessity. In terms of differential diagnosis of apnea, we have apnea of prematurity as a diagnosis of exclusion. The reason we say this, even though it's a commonest reason, we shouldn't miss any serious underlying conditions. So in the first day or two, we can consider peripartum factors like maternal sedation, use of magnesium. Intrapartum asphyxia can contribute as well. Hypoglycemia, early onset sepsis may all lead to apnea. Respiratory distress, in a baby with respiratory distress, the apnea might indicate worsening disease and the need for either surfactant therapy or increasing pressure with either CPAP or NIV. So don't ignore apnea which is happening in a baby who is acutely having respiratory distress syndrome, because this is an indication that you need to act. Don't delay your action, because the more you delay, the more you are going to worsen the condition. So act promptly and do the appropriate management. Temperature instability, intraventricular hemorrhage, sepsis, NEC, pneumonia, reflex we mentioned, and electrolyte disturbances, everything can contribute to secondary apnea. So the investigation would depend on the presentation and the differential diagnosis. Consider sepsis screen, blood glucose, electrolytes, chest and abdominal X-ray, and cranial ultrasound. It's a tricky balance how to avoid over-investigation and at the same time not missing out serious conditions like sepsis. Because in a well baby who suddenly has apneic episodes, a growing premature baby, you would be surprised that we do pick up late onset sepsis. The baby has not had any central line for a period. We are just giving CPAP or high flow, and suddenly the baby starts going limp and apnea is the first presentation. At the same time, remember that a baby who has apnea due to reflux or some factors like that, whenever the hypoxia sets in, the baby becomes hypotonic. So they do look the same, and it's reasonable that if there is no other sign of infection, you try, if they are on high flow or CPAP, you try re-recruiting the lung volume, because if you miss out re-recruiting the lung volume, the vicious cycle starts. They keep getting repeated apneic episodes because they have lost their functional residual capacity. We will discuss that in the management part as well. So this is one clue. If there are other vital signs and the responsiveness don't suggest any serious infection, you can wait 1 to 2 hours with an increased pressure on whatever mode they are getting. Even the nursing staff can be authorized to do that, so that there is no delay in this. And it's usually safe to increase the CPAP by 1 centimeter or so, or if you're on high flow, you can increase by 2 to 3 liters flow. And once the baby re-recruits the lung volume, if it is pure apnea or due to reflux or something, it will start, baby will pick up, baby will start looking better. You don't need to over-investigate. However, if the baby still stays quiet, you do need to progress with investigations. Very rarely we need ENT review if you consider an airway problem. And reflex workup is not used routinely, even in the severest cases. We may treat empirically if you do decide to treat after all the available options have been exhausted. Very rarely seizures can be presenting, and EEG may be needed to rule out a neurology consultation as well. In terms of monitoring, all of us are familiar with the monitoring tools, and pulse oximetry is a standard. Obviously, we have the saturation and the heart rate, and these are the two parameters which happen with significant apnea. So monitoring the breathing rate or the actual cessation of breathing is not essential. Desaturation with a drop in heart rate should be enough for you to pick up apnea in a self-ventilating or in a baby on non-invasive ventilation. You can look at the breathing pattern after that, and you can corroborate the pattern of apnea and the underlying causes. The thoracic impedance monitoring with the ECG leads, it gives you the heart rate and rhythm as well as the respiratory rate. So obviously it's not very sensitive, and movement artifacts are not uncommon. So we also have the apnea monitor using a Grace B capsule. This usually is in the abdominal wall and uses the breathing movement. So that again is not going to be that helpful, and you may have false positives as well. So people used a grading approach. I mean, the pulse oximeter and the ECG leads are both used in the acute phase when the infant is sickest. When they are relatively stable, you keep them just on the saturation monitor because this gives a reasonable indication. And when the baby is ready to transfer to the room, we change them to with no monitoring. And in some cases, you may use the Grace B capsule. But I should confess that very few units use this these days because it's not that reliable. So most infants in the NICUs are continuously monitored anyway for the heart rate, respiratory rate, and oxygen saturation. And we discussed impedance monitoring is potentially misleading as it's prone to artifact due to monitored body active movement. It may not detect obstructive apnea for obvious reasons as well. So when to discontinue monitoring, we discussed as well. So there is no data to suggest that a diagnosis of apnea of prematurity is associated with increased risk. So I briefly mentioned it in the early stages. Routine home monitoring for preterm infants with resolved apnea of prematurity is not recommended. So many of us face anxious parents. When we were in UK, we used to face this regularly. The parents used to ask, and that was one of the reasons we had the apnea monitors, which we used to give them home. They were warned about the false alarm and that it may not pick up all serious episodes as well. In the sickest babies with BPD, for example, when they're discharging home after a prolonged period on oxygen, for example, we sometimes loan a pulse oximeter home with the proper education on CPR and what to do and so on. That is the extreme situations, and this happens only in the extreme premature babies. So majority of the babies do not need a home monitoring, and it's like home tube feeding. We don't need that for the majority of cases, and where you do need it, you need to put a lot of thought, a lot of training, so you don't need to overdo it. In terms of the clinical course, we have increasing frequency over the first 1 to 2 weeks in most of the cases, and more than 50% of the very low birth weight and almost all of the extreme low birth weight will need treatment for apneic episodes. Majority of the clinically significant episodes resolved by 36 weeks post-conceptional age, and mostly these babies are home by 36 to 37 weeks anyway. So we should, once they go home, we should remember that RSV infection, vaccination, or any surgery like hernia, for example, which happens often in these babies, increases the risk of apnea in the ex-premature baby. So you may need to monitor them closely after any such incident. Of course, most units do not practice hospitalization to monitor, but we want the parents. Surgery, of course, we may need to consider keeping these babies in the ICU for a period of time, 24 hours or so post-surgery is the period when the highest risk is there. And RSV, we all know the role of palivizumab. We use it for selected babies and in a resource-limited setting like in some parts of India. I'm not sure how we are using this, but it has to be used only in the most high-risk cases, obviously. In Henderson Smart study on apnea, the spells stopped by 37 weeks postmenstrual age in 92% and by 40 weeks in more than 98%. The infants with BPD may have a delayed maturation of the respiratory control, and this may prolong the apnea for as long as 2 to 4 weeks beyond term. It's more common in the 24 to 26 weekers. The more severe episodes resolve first, and the very brief bradycardic episodes of uncertain clinical significance may resolve later. We also have a very detailed collaborative home infant monitoring evaluation study, studied more than 1,000 preterm and healthy term infants monitored at home. And they confirmed that extreme events where the apnea lasted more than 30 seconds or heart rate less than 60 beats for more than 10 seconds was observed most frequently in former preterm infants, very rarely in term infants. And they decreased dramatically till 43 weeks when they almost disappeared And as I said, the SIDS mostly happens in a premature baby after 47 weeks and in a term baby around 51, 52 weeks. So the 3 months to 4 months cutoff for the SIDS, and it doesn't correlate with apnea of prematurity contributing to that. In terms of management, I mean, this is halfway of the talk, so another 20 minutes or so. We have careful monitoring and recording of events by the bedside staff, which is very important. All units have a log of episodes, what you're noting down. The nurses sometimes note down whether they think it's central or obstructive or mixed, but that's not essential. They can put the precipitating factors, what is relieving the apnea, what they did as an intervention, and should assess the possible associated factors, reflux, anemia, electrolyte levels, and of course, initially you would evaluate for the secondary causes as we discussed. So general measures do help. Position of the baby plays a very important role. Avoid neck flexion and head end elevation may be considered because reflux may reduce to some extent. Prone positioning obviously is a very useful tool which most NICUs use. One of the things we should remember is that before the baby goes home, we should start nursing mainly supine because we don't advise them to put prone in their home. And prone position, we have to explain to the parents that the only reason we do it in the NICU is because we are monitoring continuously, so it is safe. So the SIDS message of back to sleep should be reinforced to the parents, and they shouldn't take a wrong message that I saw the baby prone in the NICU, I can keep the baby prone at home as well. It's very important to maintain the thermoneutral environment, and we should minimize nasal irritation and obstruction for obvious reasons. So coming on to the treatment part, majority may not need any intervention if they are bigger babies. You just monitor them. You can have the prone position and head end elevation. Tactile stimulation and oxygen might be needed. And obviously, methyl xanthines are the main part of the remaining talk. We'll discuss that in detail. And then ventilation as needed. So there are three scenarios, and I would like you to think about whether you would use apnea and when you would start, when you would stop in each of these cases. So the first one is a premature baby, 26 weeks gestation, 900 gram birth weight. Baby is ventilated since birth, received surfactant therapy. So when would you start caffeine and when would you stop? The second one is a premature baby, 32 weeks, 1,900 gram, respiratory distress at 2 hours and started on nasal CPAP. The baby was continued on CPAP for 3 days and then came off subsequently and was uneventful. There was no clinical apnea. So how would you approach this case? The third one is a premature baby, 35 weeks gestation, 2.3 kilogram. Baby was with the mother in the postnatal ward and there was a sudden color change episode following a feed. Baby was found to be apneic and limp. So after the resuscitation measures, baby was admitted to the NICU. So you can think about how you would react to these situations, and we will discuss the responses at the end of the talk. So methyl xanthines, as we discussed in the beginning, are competitive inhibitors of adenosine receptors. And adenosine is an inhibitory neuromodulator of the respiratory drive. Blockage of the adenosine receptors results in increased ventilatory responsiveness to carbon dioxide, reversal of the central hypoxic depression of breathing. So these two important mechanisms in the central reasons for apnea is reduced. Enhanced force of diaphragmatic contraction, it's a peripheral effect. And we also have improved pharyngeal muscle tone. So you have both central and peripheral mechanisms of action. In addition, caffeine is known to have a slight diuretic effect as well. So it is having another additional benefit, and it might have anti-inflammatory effect in the brain, which we will discuss later. So theophylline is rarely used these days as caffeine is more readily available. I would like to know about the availability in India. I didn't check that part. The loading dose is 4.5 to 6 milligram per kilogram, and that's a loading dose and maintenance of 1 to 1.5 milligram per kilogram 12 hourly. I used to use that when we were in PGA, and after that I've not used it since I moved to UK. I've been using caffeine all through, and it's readily available here. The cost was a factor initially, but now we have cheaper versions coming as well. Theophylline is toxic, so drug level monitoring is required in the, due to the narrow therapeutic range. And as I said, caffeine is preferred because of the longer half-life, higher therapeutic index, and the lack of need for drug level monitoring. So we have less tachycardia and less GI side effects compared to theophylline. The dosage, we can talk in terms of the caffeine citrate or the caffeine base. So the caffeine base is half of the caffeine citrate dose. Your loading dose can be 20 milligram per kilogram of caffeine citrate, and up to double this dose can be used as a loading dose. In a baby who's having multiple apneic episodes of the first loading dose, you can top up with the second loading dose before you go for the maintenance dose 24 hours after the loading dose. So we have 5 milligram per kilogram and up to 10 milligram per kilogram can be used. Some units use 10 milligram per kilogram straight away for the extreme premature babies and then reduce the dose as they grow, or they may not increase it as a baby gains weight for a period of time. So they grow into the 5 milligram per kilogram dose. And the dose can be adjusted weekly to match the weight gain, or you can let them outgrow it if you have started with a higher dose. 44% of those with BPD and 21% of those without BPD are still receiving methylxanthines at 36 weeks due to apneic episodes because of the continued need for ventilation in those with BPD. So in my experience, most of the babies stop it by 36 to 37 weeks at least. So examples of caffeine-containing drinks that we commonly drink, can you guess how much caffeine is there and how much per kilogram you're having? So coffee, especially the espresso type, has 400 milligram, and the normal coffee probably has around 150 milligram. So for a 70 kilogram adult male, you are having 2 to 4 milligram per kilogram if you drink a strong cup of coffee. And tea is a little lighter in the caffeine content, and Pepsi for a can, you're getting less than 1 milligram per kilogram. Red Bull, of course, is quite strong, and many exam-going students used to take that. Of course, it's not recommended to be taken frequently, and that's going to give you around 2 milligram per kilogram. So this is a kind of comparison with the dose that we are giving the babies. The loading dose is 20 milligram per kilogram. So it's suggested that caffeine should be commenced in all infants at less than 30 weeks of gestation. So if they are below 30 weeks, we ideally give caffeine to all of them, especially with the recent results of the CAP study and so on. And we try to start it immediately in babies receiving CPAP from birth. So this is one of the key things to improve the success of CPAP. So delaying caffeine may not be good for them. If you are ventilating and plan to extubate early as well, you try to give it. For the ventilated babies who are less than 30 weeks, many clinicians nowadays start the caffeine the first day, and we will discuss the evidence for this. Peri-extubation 24 hours before the planned extubation or within 6 hours is the alternative option, which is a more traditional way. So it's up to you whether you decide to start at extubation or you start early, but most people start early these days. Whether you give it within the golden hour or within the first day, it shouldn't make a big difference, and it may be more ideal if the baby doesn't need CPAP. You may wait for the 24-hour period before you give it. So consider starting in 30 to 34 week infants for apnea of prematurity. Of course, if they have apnea, either 1 or 2 episodes, you can go for caffeine. And obviously, if their extubation, peri-extubation dose is given, whether you continue the maintenance dose in the more mature babies, it's optional. More than 32 weeks, for example, you give the loading dose, but you don't need to continue the maintenance unless they are apneic further. So the risk of apnea of prematurity is lower, so you can decide to hold back. The evidence for the benefit of caffeine for brain development is more for the extreme premature babies, or less than 1,250 by the CAP study criteria. So to wean off from positive pressure ventilation as well, you may use caffeine because, as I said, it improves the diaphragm contractility, it reduces the hypoxia-related inhibition of breathing and so on. And post-surgical procedures, it may be used as they are at increased risk of apnea. Usually, we can continue caffeine till at least 5 apnea-free days. And we mentioned earlier that in more mature babies over 32 weeks where there is an apneic episode, you may give a loading dose for concerns of apnea, but many times that alone is enough. So you may make an order that I'm giving the loading dose now and we'll give maintenance dose if any further apnea. So that's quite reasonable. If you stop the caffeine for any reason and you're planning to restart, for example, we stop it for feed intolerance in a baby or altered aspirates because caffeine may irritate the stomach as well. You may restart without the loading dose if it's within 4 to 5 days. It's based on the half-life of caffeine. So all of you are familiar now of the caffeine in apnea of prematurity study, or the CAP study, Barbara Schmidt et al. And it was a study which was done between 1999 and 2004. And it has been occupying headlines ever since the 2008-2009, since it was published. So the study included 2006 infants with birth weights of 500 to 1,250 gram. They were randomized during the first 10 days of life to receive either caffeine or placebo. It was a very brave decision because to use placebo when caffeine was already well established, the Cochrane review even then had shown definite benefit. that they decided to use placebo and they got ethics approval. This was mainly because caffeine was having some suspected side effects on the brain. They wanted to make sure it's safe to use, and that's why they got the ethics approval. Initiation of caffeine was based on the unit practice, so it was similar to what we use at extubation, for example, or if the babies are on non-invasive, you start it early. The caffeine or placebo are continued until the drug therapy is no longer needed, so that's again the standard practice. The first study evaluated short-term outcomes before the first discharge home, and then they had follow-ups, and now we have up to the 11-year follow-up. Caffeine therapy was shown to be associated with the first report of reduced risk of PDA ligation, reduced risk of BPD, and earlier discontinuation of supplemental oxygen, shorter duration of ventilation, almost 1 week in those needing mechanical ventilation, and lower weight gain, but it was not very significant. There was no difference in the rate of death, abnormal brain ultrasound, or MEC between the two groups. So obviously caffeine was helping earlier recovery of these babies, so less complications. The 18 to 21 month follow-up showed a very surprising finding. They were looking to show caffeine as neurotoxic or to make sure it's not neurotoxic, but they found the reverse effect, that it was actually neuroprotective. So the primary outcome of composite of death, cerebral palsy, cognitive delay, deafness or blindness at corrected age of 18 to 21 months was looked at. They had 377 babies in the caffeine group which died or survived with the developmental disability versus 431 in the control group. So 40% versus 46%, and this was significant. And caffeine reduced the incidence of CP 4.4 versus 7.3%, and cognitive delay 33 to 38%. So this was statistically significant as well. So this made a lot of headlines in those days, and everyone started using caffeine. And they also had a subgroup analysis which showed that early caffeine is better in terms of PDA and BPD outcome. So less than 3 days versus more than 3 days. So people started using it right from day one, as I mentioned. So there was no significant difference in rate of death, deafness, and blindness. And the mean percentile for height, weight, head, circumference were similar. So the initial weight gain reduction did not show any long-term impact. So caffeine for apnea of prematurity improves survival without neurodisability at 18 to 21 months. So this was their conclusion. The 5-year follow-up study had a little attrition. So 15% loss was there, 1,640 babies. And the combined outcome of death or survival was compared. And these are the definitions they used. The combined outcome did not show any significant difference at this stage. So it was 21% versus 24%. There was no difference in the individual indices as well. However, they noted in a later ad hoc analysis, they showed improved motor performance in terms of coordination and other aspects in the caffeine group. And the same finding was replicated at the level. So in terms of incidence of cognitive impairment, Usha, can you mute Dr. Ritu? So in terms of incidence of cognitive impairment, thank you. Sorry for the interruption. So in terms of incidence of cognitive impairment, it was lower at 5 years than at 18 months. That's because we start getting more specific findings as you grow older. And it's similar in the two groups, 4.9% versus 5.1%. So at that stage, it was a little disappointing that the initial neurodevelopmental benefit was no longer seen. And however, the safety was clearly established. So based on this, there is no doubt that caffeine should be used where indicated. So it's definitely safe. Whether you want to start it early because of the effect being beneficial at less than 3 days versus the later onset, that's a possibility. The anti-inflammatory effect, diuretic effect might influence the above. And as caffeine is given peri-extubation in ventilated babies, this might also reflect babies with milder lung disease. So that's a key point when we come to Dr. Lodha's study, Abhay Lodha's study, which led to more people using it on day one or even as a golden hour. So the babies who received caffeine early were the ones who were already in a better condition. So that is something we should keep in mind. The 11-year study had about 24% attrition, so they had a total of 1,200 children of the same CAP study cohort. And the caffeine-treated children had better respiratory function and also reduced risk of motor impairment. So they did not significantly reduce the combined outcome. However, the motor impairment risk was reduced. So we had 19% versus 27%, and it was a significant difference. And 13 premature infants may be needed to be treated with caffeine to prevent one case of moderate to severe motor impairment at 11 years of age, which is a fairly good number. It's interesting that only 1/4 of the cases of motor impairment in this study could be attributed to clinical diagnosis of cerebral palsy. So most of the motor movement disorders in the expectant babies are not due to cerebral palsy. It's due to developmental coordination. And this developmental coordination disorder is what is improved with the caffeine therapy. So in terms of how it helps, we have the reduced inflammation on the brain, either due to the direct effect of the adenosine inhibition or because of reduced hypoxic episodes. Ventilation, as we all know, is also a pro-inflammatory factor. So reducing the ventilatory support might reduce inflammation as well. So reduced hypoxic episodes due to the central neural output and have better white matter stability as a result of all these factors. So hypoxia is known to cause white matter instability. Inflammation affects the white matter. So all these lead to better neuro-respiratory outcome as a result of caffeine use. So we mentioned this, caffeine is a non-selective inhibitor of the adenosine A2A and A1 receptors, and there could be an anti-inflammatory effect as well against the periventricular white matter from reducing hypoxia as well as the receptor effect. However, caffeine may not be a benign intervention. There are studies which have actually shown in animals that cerebral and intestinal blood flow velocity is reduced by inhibition of the adenosine receptors. It also reduces short-term weight gain, increases heart rate, jitteriness, irritability, and seizures. Caffeine was reported to have adverse molecular and cellular effects on the developing brain as well. And there are studies which have confirmed that caffeine actually increases the threshold of seizures in the babies related to IVH or other factors in the newborn period. So caffeine can have adverse effects, so we shouldn't assume it is safe, especially in the acute phase. So use it with caution as well. So the European Consensus Guidelines considers all these factors. All of you are familiar with the 2019 update. So caffeine prophylaxis soon after admission has become the standard based on cohort studies. I will discuss Dr. Abeloda's study as well before I finish. A clinical trial of prophylactic caffeine versus placebo was abandoned early. I'll mention this study as well by Professor Bankalari's group. Caffeine should be used to facilitate weaning from mechanical ventilation. So this is a grade A1, which is very strongly established. Early caffeine should be considered for babies at high risk of needing mechanical ventilation, such as those using non-invasive respiratory support. So starting early in those needing non-invasive respiratory support, there is no doubt. So even though the evidence is C1, it should be used. But they don't say that we should start in ventilated babies at zero age, which is the one that we should be careful about when we start. So this study by Dr. Abhay Lodha was published in Pediatrics in 2019, and they had the cohort. It was not a prospective study. It was not a randomized study. They had a cohort which was studied, and neonates under 29 weeks were selected. They had two groups. The change of practice was what they used, I think, received within 2 days of birth, and late caffeine where it was received after 2 days of birth. The primary outcome was significant neurodevelopmental impairment as cerebral palsy, BSID score less than 70, hearing aid or cochlear implant or visual impairment at 18 to 24 months corrected age. They had a good number of babies. 1,545 were in the early caffeine group and 563 were in the late caffeine group. So the rates of BPD, PDA and severe neurologic injury were lower in the early caffeine group, and lower significant neurodevelopmental impairment was shown. The BSID score, cognitive score less than 85 was significantly lower in the early caffeine group as well. So they concluded that early caffeine therapy is associated with better neurodevelopmental outcome in the babies born less than 29 weeks. So this study prompted many people to start using it in the golden hour, and already people were doing it after the ad hoc post hoc analysis and the CoCAP study as well. However, I mean, Professor Bankalari's group started this study, early caffeine and weaning from mechanical ventilation in preterm infants. And this was published in 2018. The study was not published, not completed, because after they recruited around 80 babies, they showed that there was a higher mortality in the one of the groups. So when they unblinded the study, they found that it was in the early caffeine group. So the way I did the study is preterm infants born at 23 to 30 weeks requiring mechanical ventilation in the first 5 days. So they didn't include the ones who are on non-invasive because that group is clear cut. They need the caffeine. So these babies were randomized to receive a 20 milligram per kg loading dose followed by maintenance right from day one or when they were considered ready. The placebo was given, a blinded loading dose of caffeine was given in view of the clear benefit of caffeine at extubation in these babies. They did get a loading dose even if they were in the placebo group, but that was only at extubation. So the age at first successful extubation did not differ between the early caffeine, so it didn't change the course of the lung disease by itself. A non-significant trend towards reduced in the higher mortality in the early caffeine group led to a cautious decision to stop the trial. So this study is warning us that we shouldn't rush to conclusions based on some evidence. Obviously, Dr. Abhay Lodha's study and even the CAP study, the conclusion is not that caffeine is totally neuroprotective. It's just that the babies who received earlier caffeine probably were given caffeine early because of their clinical ability to extubate early. So that is the point we should keep in mind. They were relatively more stable babies, and so they had a better neurodevelopmental outcome when caffeine was given early as well. So caffeine is helpful, but when we give it is still open to debate. In terms of the other modes, we will just run through them because you're all familiar with this. So non-invasive ventilation can be considered even after methyl xanthine therapy. The baby has multiple apneic episodes when the infant does not respond to tactile stimulation and when an event requires IPPV to terminate apnea. So this is a slight difference from the point I mentioned earlier that we should be aggressive with starting the treatment. So when the baby is already on ventilation, you don't need to hesitate to increase it to a brief period to re-recruit. And when you have a new episode happening, you need to assess the baby better. And it also involves more expense in terms of the circuit being taken. And also you can wait a little bit to know what's happening, but don't wait too long. Don't delay it, because the more apneic episodes happen, the more the FRC is lost, the more lung de-recruits, and you're going to waste valuable time. So you don't need to strictly follow this. If you're clear that there is no other cause and baby is not responding to methyl xanthine therapy, especially in the more small babies, put them back on the high flow or CPAP they were on if you have just taken them off. So be practical in your approach and don't delay re-recruiting the lung in these babies. CPAP is effective mainly for mixed and obstructive apnea. The central component also is affected though when you have more stable chest wall and you don't have the central inhibitory reflex of the distortion of the chest wall. You also have better FRC maintained, so the hypoxia related central drive is affected. So it's not just mixed apnea but also central apnea, but the primary effect is on the mixed and obstructive apnea. And if CPAP is not adequate, NAV can be tried, and NAPPV may be tried if you have the option. High flow may work as well, and it can be used. If persistent episodes, even on CPAP needing IPPV, baby will need mechanical ventilation. So mostly this secondary causes are in the immediate post-extubation period. For example, the baby fails CPAP and presents with apnea. That's because the baby tires out, is de-recruited the lung and is not able to cope. So this is a subgroup of the small babies who are extubated early. You may need to re-ventilate. Usually the ventilator requirements are minimal as the underlying lung condition is good, unless it's a worsening due to pneumonia or other factors. If the hemoglobin is low, as we discussed, you may have a slightly higher threshold, but doesn't mean you transfuse them with the hemoglobin of 12 or 13, for example. If it is 9 or so, you may transfuse them, but not otherwise. Don't have very low thresholds to transfuse, a very high threshold to transfuse, even if there is apnea. So when to discontinue therapy, ventilation and CPAP are weaned as clinically appropriate. And methyl xanthine, as we discussed, it's continued till the baby is free of apnea for 5 to 7 days at a gestation between 32 to 34 weeks. It's a longer period if the apnea persists. So the more premature the baby, the longer you are going to continue it. It's preferable for the baby to be off methyl xanthine for at least 5 days. Most units continue the methyl xanthine if the baby continues to have BPD because of the additional benefits. And if the baby is needing non-invasive ventilation, you keep it on till you're off the non-invasive ventilation first. Home cardiorespiratory monitoring is not routinely offered. In some cases, as we said, you may consider it. So in terms of outcome, obviously anything related to hypoxia may cause neurodevelopmental delay. So repeated apnea could cause neurodevelopmental delay, but in terms of regular apnea of prematurity in otherwise healthy baby, there is no evidence that it causes a neurodevelopmental problem. So it's more related to the extreme prematurity, the other factors related to the brain development that lead to the neurodevelopmental problem, not just the apnea itself. However, recurrent hypoxic episodes are not good for any baby, and you do need to be aggressive with the treatment if they have significant hypoxic episodes. There is no clear evidence, as we said, but you have to monitor them as you would for any premature baby. So coming back to the three scenarios, I think you might have already deduced the answers based on what we discussed. So this baby is a preterm 26-weeker, ventilated and given surfactant. So there is no doubt caffeine needs to be given for this baby. So you can either give the caffeine soon after the decision for extubation is made. You can use within the golden hour. I'm not sure. I'm not convinced that it is necessary. You could give it within the first 24 hours for these babies because they are likely to need it. And you could extubate early in most of these situations if the baby is not ready for extubation at 2 hours, as in this case. The maintenance dose of 5 mg/kg is continued usually till 34 weeks or longer if there is BPD. And a higher dose can be considered if there is persistent apnea, the 10 mg/kg dose. The second case was a preterm 31 or 32 weeks with 1,700 grams. The respiratory distress at 2 hours and started on CPAP. So there was no clinical apnea after the CPAP stopped. So in this baby, you could start on caffeine after the loading dose from day 2 to 3 or even early on. And it stopped at 34 weeks if the apnea is free, if the baby is apnea free for 3 to 5 days. You can also start if apneic episodes occur, so you could go either way. And in terms of the 35-weeker, obviously the color change episode is more like an aspiration episode or incoordinate or medication defect or something, or even sepsis. So it's very important to evaluate. It's unlikely to be apnea of prematurity. It's a 35-weeker who suddenly had an apneic episode in the ward with the color change. So other factors have to be evaluated, and you have to be careful about not missing infection. For example, in this baby, you may consider a loading dose of caffeine after the evaluation. And as I said, you may not need to continue the maintenance dose unless there is any further apnea. So to conclude, apnea of prematurity is a very common clinical problem in the premature babies. Methyl xanthines are commonly used with CPAP or ventilation as needed. The CAP study results show possible neurodevelopmental outcome benefit of caffeine. However, there is still controversy on when to start caffeine in the extreme low birth weight babies who are not on non-invasive ventilation. That is, in the ventilated babies, whether you want to give it right from day zero or you wait till 24 hours or even at extubation. So the outcome is good, and apnea usually resolves in almost all babies by 36 to 43 weeks or so. So it was a detailed presentation. I'm sorry about the length of it, and I hope we have some time for questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sridhar, for such a important topic being discussed very well in detail and also in a fashion which could be understood by all of us. And we have a very good audience of 102 people for your talk. And I have about 6 or 7 questions. Can we take each question one by one?
Yes, please.
I think you are not audible. Giri, just can you have a look? I don't think he's audible.
Okay.
I'll give you the first question by Dr. Abdul Qasim. What is the relation or association between apnea prematurity and brief resolved unexplained events or ALT? That is your first question, Dr. Sridhar.
Obviously, acute life-threatening events can happen in any baby and even in the postnatal area. So when we are in the NICU in a premature baby, most of the time they are being monitored closely. So we should pick them up before they reach a situation when we call it a life-threatening episode. But when a baby is in the postnatal ward, any apnea could be a life-threatening episode. So any of the secondary cases could actually qualify for this. And some babies, term babies, may have a delayed maturation of the brain, or they may have other secondary factors. So you should work them up. But mostly, if it's a borderline premature baby, it could be apnea of prematurity presenting as acute life-threatening event. I did make the clarification between sudden infant death and ALT.
Yes.
Yes, Dr. Jalil.
Is it,
Next question is Dr. Jalil, you can post your questions in the chat box. We will take up oral questions at the end in case we have time. The second question is from Dr. Giridhar. What is the difference between apnea prematurity and intermittent hypoxia?
Intermittent hypoxia can happen in a ventilated baby as well, and it's more related to the pulmonary vascular adaptation. So this is more related to the chronic lung disease babies and the pulmonary vascular changes we see with them. Intermittent hypoxemic episodes, it may happen in a baby on non-invasive ventilation. It may happen. It may be due to the shunting related effects, whether the PDA is open or it's just the intrapulmonary shunting. So apnea is one of the reasons for intermittent hypoxia, but not the only reason. And intermittent hypoxia, which goes below a certain level, is serious. We'll be taking measures for that.
And he has also got many questions. I'll add one more question. What is the ideal signal averaging time to be fixed or in the pulse oximeter?
Yes. Yeah. So if you have a quick, a rapid signal averaging time, it can fluctuate more. So if you have a stable baby, you can have 4 to 6 seconds as a signal averaging time. But if you are in the labor room and you want to pick it up very soon, the Masimo-like signal extraction technology is shown to be more effective, and also a lower signal averaging time will give you a quicker reading. So if you are in the NICU, anything around 4 to 6 seconds should be fine.
Okay. Dr. Usha has got a question. See, in case you discharge a baby on caffeine by 34 weeks, do you stop caffeine? When do you stop caffeine during follow-up? At 36 weeks or at... though we generally don't discharge babies, her question is in case they had to discharge by 34 weeks on caffeine.
Very interesting question, because I have seen many patients who come from India where it was a 28-weeker, for example, who has been discharged when they are just 32 or 33 weeks and they are 1.4, 1.5 kilos. So quite early discharge, probably due to socioeconomic reasons. So you have to be sure. I mean, it's probably a bit risky, especially if you are not having home monitoring. So you can try to discourage, but if the baby has been stable on caffeine, again, when you stop it, you may have to have some form of monitoring, because we don't know when, and probably it's safer to continue it. But it's not going to be evidence-based, my answer, because it's as good a guess as anyone else. So you have to be cautious, try to avoid that situation if possible. Even in that baby, you may try stopping it for a couple of days to know if it's safe to discharge the baby as well. So that probably is a better response than sending them home on a medicine which complains. We cannot guarantee once they go home, we don't know how the baby will respond when you stop it. So it's probably safer to stop it by 2-3 days when you're planning the discharge, and at least assess the response once you stop it before you send them.
Yeah, maybe I think a post-discharge follow-up also could answer, because as you said, we might be in the socioeconomic status. We have to discharge a little earlier. We don't wait for 1.8 or 2 kg, in which case that may happen. And again, another question on the dosage. What is the highest dosage, or how do you do your dose escalation in case of refractory apnea?
I know there are studies which have used quite high doses, up to 80 milligram per kilogram, but I personally don't go beyond 2 loading doses, up to 40 milligram per kilogram. And as I said, it cannot be taken as an absolutely safe drug. There is evidence available that people have used, but it's all small studies or single reports. And so you are safe if you use up to 40 milligram per kilogram, followed by a maintenance of 10 milligram per kilogram. I'm talking of the caffeine citrate dose. Caffeine-based dose will be half of that.
And I think that comes to the end of the questions which were posted in the chat box. Dr. Giri, if we have time, can we allow somebody now? I think you can unmute Dr. Jalil in case he has got any question.
There is one more question by Dr. Uma Maheshwari. She wants to know what can be the maximal dose of caffeine that can be used. I think we already answered that, sir. And your experience with doxepram is something she wants.
I mean, in PGA, I think we tried in a couple of babies, but nothing after that. I mean, in central apnea, on-demand scurs kind of situation, sometimes we have tried, but I don't have much experience with it, to be honest.
So I think
Dr. Kumada, can I just add one thing because about this caffeine, Dr. Sridhar, it is a very nice, wonderful, detailed presentation and very simple terms. So everything is very clear. This question about the increase in the dose of caffeine, especially we have this what Legends conference every 2 times a month in Kerala. Mm-hmm. And Dr. Barbara Schemitz from Canada, she also spoke on this caffeine, and she is also now very skeptical about increasing the dose of caffeine because there are some adverse effects also reported. So she is of the opinion we should not reload the dose, even if there is a recurrence of apnea, reloading is dangerous. Okay. Probably keep on to the same dose and investigate for the other reasons. Hmm. Maybe because everybody just go on increasing caffeine. Caffeine is one drug which has been given a green signal by Cochrane also. But you have to be careful.
That's true. Like anything in neonatology, too much may be bad.
Yeah. Okay.
And again, Dr. Sridhar, I wanted to answer your question that caffeine is freely available even in the public sector. And we no longer use aminophilin. I think most of the units are using only caffeine.
Yeah, we haven't seen aminophilin for a long time now.
Yes. No,
in Australia and all, aminophilin was the only drug available in 1980s. But now the thing has totally changed for caffeine.
If I have not seen any more questions, if anybody else wants to raise